So some of the questions came, sir. Could you please mention me the list of metal responsible for groundwater pollution? So metal means it is not like you say, for example, say the like heavy metal pollution like say lead its compounds or silver that compound. So a variety of contaminations are there. So that is it is not like the directly metal, but it's variations. It's like it is just like what is available in the ore or whatever it is there. So that is can be the source of pollution. So then like arsenic, as I mentioned, is another source of pollution. So now another question by Pravat Kumar Swain is how to mining of groundwater. So how can it help the rural areas? So mining of groundwater means I do not know, the question is not so clear. Mining of, so that means when we are pumping water from the ground, the aquifer system, it is so, but mining can be a major source of pollution. So that you please remember, mining is many areas, so many areas, especially mining will not be in wherever human population very much is there, but in especially areas where that much population is not there. But that is a major source of pollution since they use a lot of salts and other things for the variety of operation. But mining can be major source of pollution, and there we need to look into that bit. And then another question is by Mikhail Bini, how can groundwater being polluted by leachate from landfill sites be remediated? So landfill site, as I mentioned, though even if we are doing paka very effective scientific landfilling, then issue may can be reduced. But many times lot of fractures can be there, and through that fracture the leachate can go down to the aquifer system, and pollution can take place. So here how it can be remediated is, of course, many techniques we have seen. So like if it is that, what kind of how it can be, the questions, as I hope after going through all this lecture you would have seen that there is a we first we have to identify what kind of pollution is there, and then depending upon the pollution we need to identify, say for example, if it is volatile organic contaminants, like then air sparging or the circulation wells, all those things are possible. But if it is like by organic compounds, then we can go for a bioremediation. So that depends upon what kind of pollution, where it is polluted, how deep it is polluted. So that kind of things we need to look into. So that is from Mikhail. And then Keshav Chandran, is TDS test sufficient for the quality of groundwater as a random test? So to certain extent, since one of the major pollution is most of the time totally sort of TDS, is that is sufficient. Means, of course, there can be other source of pollution also, but TDS is generally what we consider one source of groundwater is concerned. TDS test is to certain extent it will be good enough, but then it depends upon the location also. Say for example, as I mentioned, the heavily polluted area like Pattanjeru or the Palar, all these areas, then we need to look for further things also. But TDS can be a major source of pollution. Then Dr. Ramakrishna has asked, I would like to know what models are using in India to restore groundwater recharge. Groundwater recharge is concerned here also. We can use the simulation optimization model. Recharge is concerned, you see that though central groundwater body is coming with a number of projects, but that is not done very large scale. So in many places like Arizona and other region, they go for very large scale recharge. But recharge is also, recharge is very important since it can reduce the pollution, it can be through dilution. So for example, in a Bengal belt where our arsenic is a major problem, there can be a good source of recharge, can be very, very effective. So for that, we can use the simulation and optimization model. So that is, in India, it is not massive scale, it is not done, but maybe like rainwater harvesting itself. So in your own land, you can go for rainwater harvesting, and then the running water, we can allow the water to walk, the walking water, wherever it is slowly moving, then we can stop it intermittently so that water will be penetrating, infiltrating down, and that will improve the water quality. And then another question, please elaborate on groundwater quality near Ganga River. Ganga River is, you see that mainly, you see the river itself is polluted, then of course, then actually the groundwater is concerned. major majority of our groundwater resources are in Ganga basin, but unfortunately, since there's so much surface water is there, people are not using that much, but only locally the villages are pumping the water for their irrigation or drinking purpose. But there the pollution sources, like you know that government of India is putting so much of money for last 20 to 30 years, and then still we are not able to, the surface water is polluted. So many rain, so much of the small streams coming to Ganga, that is polluted, means obviously there's corresponding groundwater is also polluted. You see that there is always an interaction between surface water and groundwater. So that way, we need to look into. So that way, many groundwater resources in Ganga River basin will be also polluted. That is, lot of studies is required to identify. And then Dr. Ravindra has asked, what is in situ remediation method to reduce TDS? Of borewell water. So as I mentioned, in situ technology is that without pumping means we need to say like one promising technology is called groundwater circulation. Well, actually, that technique was developed in Germany and still not much European countries it is used, but not come to India. So that is hydraulic technique. But in situ remediation in India, what we can try is that bioremediation. So bioremediation means once you identify that area, we can go for identify some bacteria, what kind of bacteria can remove these kinds of contamination. So here, please remember TDS, that depends upon if it is a TDS, like what kind of TDS it is there. So bioremediation is possible only if it is organic contamination. If it is like other kind of like sodium chloride or other thing, then that is not possible. There another option is that either pump and treat or the circulation also not possible if it is sodium chloride, that kind of contamination. So there the option is that on-site technique like pump and treat. Then Pravat Kumar Swain has lots of fluoride containing groundwater is available in different parts of the India, such as Bengal and other. Is there any commercial technology to remove fluoride from water and make it drinkable? So certain filters are available. That is, I don't have that details with me, but once the water is pumped and identified fluoride, then it can be filtered and then remove it. But in all these areas, one advantage of like another person asked, like recharging. The recharging is one important technique. So you can recharge a lot of groundwater and that will dilute all these issues. So that is one way. And for groundwater modeling, which model will be suitable for prediction study? So as I mentioned, though I presented two models, so generally used the model is called say ModFlow MT3D. ModFlow MT3D, that is a pre-model available, but with the graphical user interface, you need to pay some money. GMS, groundwater modeling system, is available. GMS, groundwater modeling system. You can download it freely for some time, and then they can even give a trial run for one month. And then using that, you can do some simulation, and then if you are interested, you can buy it. For academic institution, they give 50% reduction is given, and it will be around 2.5 lakh for academic institutions. Otherwise, it will be around 4 lakh plus will be the model. So that is a groundwater modeling system can be used for simulation. So that there you can use finite difference method, finite volume, finite element method. FM water is there. Then ModFlow, MT3DMS, all those things are available. So now Parvat Kumar again asked, how do mining of groundwater, how can it help to rural areas? I think that is already answered. Okay. So how effective for optimization study, which model will be suitable for whether PS or ANN? PS, ANN is not an optimization tool as such. It is a mainly data-driven technique. PSO is the best model which we have identified. Many places you can utilize PSO. Actually, 5-6 papers we have published already. If you search with my name, you can see scientific papers using PSO. How effective are constructed wetlands as an in-situ remediation process? So constructed wetland, as you can see, that is for this the surface way of doing. It is not for groundwater, but if an industrial effluent is there, we can put into constructed wetlands, and then using weeds or that variety of things can be grown, and that will reduce the contamination, and that way we can go for that. So constructed wetland is also very useful for especially surface water pollution, and we can utilize constructed wetlands. How we can control the natural leaching of arsenic and manganese, etc. So that I already answered. So this is a natural leaching is mainly many places in Bengal and other region. Too much water is pumped out, so that is why leaching is taking place. So that is to be controlled. Controlled way pumping may not have this arsenic and other kind of problem. So there you have to control it with how much you are pumping out, and then also you can go for recharge. Groundwater recharge can reduce that kind of problem. And then Rohit Vinod has asked, what about use of zero valent ion non-particles for groundwater remediation? Yes, that can be also used, but you need to identify what kind of contamination can be utilized. And then disadvantage is that you have to identify the location of the hotspot and then introduce that, and that its effectiveness is to be. Since groundwater pollution is concerned, it is a problem to problem, it is keep on varying. Since I cannot generalize, or we cannot generalize what is there, so that is the issue. So you can you need to study it in detail, and then you need to identify what kind of pollution, how much it extends the pollution, and then what kind of treatment methods. And then another question is, sir, will the same simulation model for groundwater be applicable for surface water as well? So groundwater and surface water, it is different technique, the simulation. Simulation for surface water is we can, since the equations will be different, so that way surface water modeling system, those who want to look for modeling in this area, surface SMS is there, surface water modeling system. So in case of studying the transport and distribution contamination in hilly terrain area with very little or no groundwater availability, but high rainfall area, what model should we go for? So there the surface water modeling also, transport equation is almost same. So there you need to identify the hydrodynamics first in the through the river, and then if a pollutant is introduced, how it will be affecting the aquatic system. So that is what we need to see. Then Sishan Ahmed has the optimum treatment of dye in industrial water. So optimum treatment is concerned, that is what I say, that is treatment technology is concerned, say the maximum, so all the in dye water, there will be a lot of TDS will be there, so many pollutants will be there. So that is a minimal level we need to come down. Of course, industrial standards are available, so I am not going to get that details. If you search in internet, you can get all those details. So another question is, Priya Xavier asked how to treat ocean water. Ocean water is concerned, of course, that desalination plants are available. So you can see that we can pump the saline water directly from the sea, or you can have a pumping wells near the coastal aquifer system. So advantage of pumping from coastal aquifer is that salinity will be less and treatment cost will be less. So that is why many countries will be adopting coastal aquifer system for desalination. And then we need to pump it out and then treat it properly. So using various filtering techniques or also the variety of filters, nano filter, and all those things are available. And then Shivashankar has asked, what are factors responsible for spreading of water pollutant? So the spreading is, as I mentioned, once a contamination is introduced, so the hydrodynamics taking place, like diffusion will be there, advection will be there, dispersion will be there. So these are the processes what will be taking place. So depending upon hydraulic gradient, say for example, if you are having a near pumping well, then the movement of water will be groundwater will be very fast. So that the control will be also difficult. So then Guneshwar has asked, please tell the difference between air stripping and air sparging. So air stripping, air sparging means we simply put high pressure air is introduced to the volatile organic contaminant where it is there, and then that is called air sparging. Air stripping is that particular area we put it even the air stripping can be used for pumped out water. Air sparging can be in situ of the removal of the contamination, especially for volatile organic contaminants. So this air stripping or air sparging is mainly for volatile organic contaminants. And then finally, again, Shivashankar has again asked, it is heard that mercury in our tubelet will leak into soil and water source on dumping. Yes, that is true. So the thing is that we have to restrict you should be environmentally conscious. You should not throw away your tube light or any of these things, but do for scientifically, we need to treat it, and so that will not affect our soil or aquatic system. So soil is polluted means, of course, your water will be also polluted. And then can we create a simulation to calculate the radioactive substances? Of course, that can be done. So that is we can either the surface water, groundwater, we can create a simulation, and then that you can show that how far it is spreading, how fast it is spreading. All those things can be done using simulation models. That is definitely possible. Then again, last question, does chlorination causes groundwater pollution? Chlorination is to a certain extent, you see that silver chloride content is to a certain level, that is good, but when it is exceeding certain level, that is again become a pollution. So that is, we need to see that range, and then you see that CPHE manuals or the in India or other World Health Organization, how much it can be there, that range is there. Within that range, it is safe. But if it is exceeding, it will be a pollution. So that is like that kind of solvent. Since chlorination, if it is chlorination exceeds, then we can go for various kinds of treatment options. So as I mentioned, so that is about the questions come here. So that is, I think I have answered most of the question. So I am putting back to Mr. Jha. Yes, please.
Sir, there is one question by Jonathan Singh. How effective are constructed wetlands as in C2 remediation process?
So as I think I already answered that constructed wetlands is not for groundwater, but mainly for effluent treatment. So constructed wetlands, what it does is that we can put through, develop a constructed wetland using reeds or variety of vegetation, and then that can be that the polluted effluent can be put into that, and that the plants will absorb that the contamination, I mean the polluted, and that will be the water, is the surface water is treated, means obviously the groundwater below or the that is also treated. So constructed wetland is not for groundwater treatment, but that is for the surface, the effluent treatment from the industry or the domestic wastewater can be treated using the constructed wetlands. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Eldo. We have covered all from the chat box and from the Q&A tab. And let me thank on behalf of the audience, Professor Eldo, for your insightful talk on the groundwater pollution remediation and management.